In exactly 15 seconds, we'll be on the air.
Welcome to Restoration Stage Radio. I'm your host, Harris James. Our story this evening is entitled Live from the Whitelaw Hotel, a new musical comedy by Stephen A. Butler Jr. and directed by Courtney Baker Oliver. The setting. Welcome to the plush lobby of the fabulous and segregated Black-owned and operated Whitelaw Hotel, located just a block off of Washington, D.C.'s famous U Street. It is late December, 1930-something. Light snow has been falling for the past few weeks, but not enough to shut down the hustle and bustle of the vibrant city. The devastation of the Great Depression has settled in across the country and is finally directing its fury on the country's last stronghold, the capital city. Black Washingtonians and Black Americans nationwide have always had to struggle more to get less than their white counterparts, but the Depression is another matter entirely. The only Black folks not completely flattened by the Depression are the working entertainers who are paid to keep the rest of the country from going crazy and those who make a living serving them. It's the wee hours of a snowy morning. The grand lobby of the Whitelaw Hotel is unusually quiet. It's the busiest time of the hotel's year. It won't stay quiet long. This weekend, the hotel is fully booked as the de facto host hotel for the popular holiday concert and amateur contest at the Howard Theater nearby. If that wasn't enough excitement, the concert headliner, legendary jazz singer Esther Evans, has booked the presidential suite for the weekend and will be arriving in a few hours. The characters. First, we have Rita Thomas, a natural beauty and no-nonsense taking front desk clerk. Rita has been working at the Whitelaw for over 10 years now and has climbed as high as the ranks allow a woman in the 1930s. I'm sure some of our female listeners can relate to her struggle. Next, we have Claudette Chambers, the beautiful but hard and taxi dancer. Like so many colored women, Claudette made her way to Washington from the deep South in search of a better life for herself and her family. She'll do whatever it takes to get it. She is a Whitelaw regular thanks to the revolving door of rich lovers who keep her. That brings us to Irene Birdie Hicks. Always a dreamer and a little naive, Birdie is a sweet country girl who finds herself smack in the middle of city life when she decides to take a temporary job at the Whitelaw for the holiday season with her on again, off again boyfriend, William. Next, we meet William Thomas, a former farmhand and younger brother of Rita. William has followed Birdie to the Whitelaw. He is a good-hearted young man, but won't completely commit to Birdie for fear of missing out on something better. Sounds like our little Birdie is gonna have her hands full with this one. Now it's time to meet Esther Evans. Once the most popular singer of her time, Esther walked away from the spotlight to raise her now grown son, BJ, and to take care of her ailing husband and band leader, Buster. During her hiatus, Esther watched her contemporary surpass her. With her husband dead, she's ready to reclaim her throne. We'll be rooting for you, Miss Evans. Next, we have the ever so debonair BJ Evans. The only child of Esther and Buster, BJ's goal is to make a name for himself. BJ has agreed to play for his mother during her comeback tour. Handsome and full of himself, BJ seems to have everything going for him. Something's a little fishy about this one. Enter Velma Gifford. Velma is a pushy and resilient newspaper reporter for the Washington Bee, the local colored newspaper. Raised in privilege and boarding schools, then sent to Howard University to complete her education, Velma sometimes has a hard time fitting in. Her old Hollywood transatlantic accent doesn't help. A colored woman with a transatlantic accent? Now this I want to hear. Finally, we round out our cast with Leland Morris. Mockingly referred to as Mr. President, Leela is the stuffy, straight-laced manager of the Whitelaw. He's the only person who knows more about it than Rita. And now that you all know all the players, it seems like we're ready to begin. Velma enters in a huff, carrying a camera around her neck and a stack of newspapers, a notepad, and pens. She is dressed in proper business attire. Rita pulls out a feather duster out of her apron and hands it to Birdie, instructing her to continue dusting as she heads back over to the front desk. Birdie is seen listening to the conversation in the background.
Rita? There you are. Am I late? Did I miss it? She didn't arrive yet, did she? Please tell me she didn't, because if I don't get this buzz, Mr. Chase will surely throw me out on my ear, don't you know?
Calm down, Velma. She isn't here yet.
Thank heavens.
Velma, breathing a sigh of relief, camps out at the front desk. Rita joins her as Birdie timidly looks on.
Coffee?
Please. I've been up since the crack of dawn trying to find something compelling to write about, since it looks like everyone has given up on dear old Amelia. Poor thing. What in the world would make a rich white woman like her want to fly, let alone go up in one of those metal clunkers by herself in the first place? After that whole Hindenburg mess, you would think white folks would learn to keep their feet on the ground.
Well, you know how these rich white folk are. They always looking for some new adventure.
Whatever she was looking for, I sure hope she found it, because it looks like folks have given up trying to find her.
Rita pours and serves Velma a cup of coffee.
So what does your boss want you to write about now?
The same thing every other paper in town is writing about. The talent show at the Howard Theater. I mean, what else is there to say? It's not like we don't do it every year.
Well, it always does seem to sell out.
But that alone doesn't make it newsworthy, which is why my editor, Mr. Chase, at the 12th hour, I might add, has given me orders to find some new angle to write about. That's why I'm hoping I can convince Her Highness, Miss Evans, to finally give me a story, because all these other rags have everything else covered. Why, the contest even made the post this year. Of course, they were just as uppity and racist as they've always been.
I'm surprised I'm even still in business after the whole Carrie Johnson mess.
Velma beckons Rita to come closer as she reads from a newspaper. Birdie listens.
Listen to this. Have your New Year's Eve plans fallen through? Well, if so, why not rub elbows with the good common colored folk at the Howard Theater as they bring in the new year with their annual talent contest? With all the good food and great music offered, you'll almost forget that you're not at the more prestigious Warner. Good common folk, this is the same paper that claimed only 27 people died out there in Tulsa.
We know that wasn't true. And someone needs to tell them that ever since their depression hit, common folk come in white too.
Birdie places her feather duster down and picks up one of Velma's newspapers. She peruses it in amazement.
I ain't never seen no newspaper with no real pictures in it, folk. Papers back home just had drawings in them. But I guess that don't matter much, because all folks really use the paper for back home to see what show they be playing at the movie show. Which is always at least 2 months behind anyway. I tell you, it just broke them whole colored children's hearts when they found out the Snow White movie wasn't going to be coming to New Bug until May. They said, oh, the white children had to see it first. Then Walt Disney folks, they put them posters and things all over the place back home. And you can't even turn on the radio without hearing that hi-ho song every 5 minutes. I tell you, it ain't fair. See, I saved up my money. They saved up their 25 cents, just like everybody else. They should be able to see the Little People movie too.
Velma gently pulls the newspaper out of Birdie's hands and places it back in her stack.
Heartbreaking. And you all?
Oh, sorry. I'm Birdie. I mean, Irene Hicks. I'm not around here.
Velma offers Birdie her hand. Birdie shakes it vigorously.
Velma Gifford of the Washington Bee. Nice to meet you, Miss Hicks. And what brings you to the Whitelaw?
Well, we and I just came up for the contest.
How charming. Love struck, down on their luck couple, risk everything to make it big in the entertainment industry. Tell me, Irene, how long have you been performing?
Well, I'm not really a performer. Well, except for that time I was with circus.
The circus? You used to be in a circus? Fascinating.
Oh, yes. That's where I met my William.
Velma, wait a minute. I think you may have the wrong idea.
Oh, this is buzzworthy indeed. Young circus performers fall in love and fight for the first prize at the Howard Theater by Velma Gifford. Just wait until Mr. Chase hears about this. Why, this might even get me the front page.
Velma quickly jumps up and positions Birdie for a photo.
Do you mind, dear?
Oh, no, shut no. Well, this is more sad than when my uncle ever got struck by lightning.
Now, I want you to smile, but not too hard. I still need you to look, well, poor.
Birdie awkwardly places her hands on her hips as Velma takes the photo.
Perfect. Now, I may need to take another one tomorrow if this one here is not up to snuff.
Velma, you might want to slow down.
No time for that, dearie. My editor needs this story yesterday. And if I know him, he's probably already up to his elbows in ink. Now, what was the name of that circus again?
It was called the Arlen Thomas Cub Circus. Well, it was called that for Mr. Old Boswell stole it from him.
Just like that, our story has a villain. I'll tell you, with a scoop like this, I might not lose my job after all.
Are you really gonna put my picture in the paper?
William, now dressed in his uniform, enters carrying a shovel. He is followed by Leland.
You bet you I am. This has all the makings of a great New Year's story. Even old Mr. Chase will see that. But winning that contest wouldn't hurt.
What contest?
Oh, William, isn't this exciting? I ain't even started working here yet, and my fish are gonna be in the paper. I told you working here at this hotel was gonna be fun. Ooh-wee.
Working? What do you mean, working?
Working, as in making beds, cleaning toilets, and carrying luggage?
Velma, that's what I've been trying to tell you. Irene and my brother William here are only working at the Whitelaw. They ain't got nothing to do with no contest.
But I don't know how anyone would be expected to know that since she's still not in her uniform.
I'm getting to it, Leland.
Birdie, finally realizing who Leland is, runs up to introduce herself by giving him another of her demonstrative handshakes.
He's so handsome, Mr. Leland. I just want to say thank you so much for this here job, and I'm going to work real hard for you. Believe you me.
Golly gee. See, I ain't never been in no fancy place like this before. Well, except for when my daddy died and the morticians, they took his body to the wrong funeral home. Oh, it was real nice. Plush coffee, electric lights, and everything. Just like this. Boy, you should have seen the look on the white folks' face when they opened up the casket and saw my daddy laying there, just dead. You know, I reckon you all could make a whole lot of money if y'all did funerals here. Well, I bet you have folks just line up around the corner, have their funeral rites in a nice place, just like this.
Rita.
I've got it, Leland. Irene, let's go find you that uniform.
Okay, Mr. Leland. We'll talk later, because I got a whole bunch of ideas just like that.
Birdie exits up the stairs excitedly. Rita follows her. as she exits.
And William, can you make yourself useful by clearing that snow off the stoop?
William heads towards the exit begrudgingly, mumbling under his breath as he leaves.
Double snow. Hell, I could stay in Newburgh if I did that.
Leland and Velma look on as Rita and William exit.
I need a drink. A drink.
Oh, get off the edge, Leland. They'll be fine. And that mousy one is a riot. Besides, where's your holiday spirit?
Probably in the bread line, which is where I'm going to be when Mr. Whitelaw finds out I've just hired Amos and his girl Sapphire to work in his hotel.
Well, might as well save me a place too. If I don't get Mr. Chase a story in soon, I'm going to be right there in line with you. He's already been threatening to make me his new social editor.
Social editor? What's wrong with that?
Velma is highly offended by the question.
What's wrong with that? I did not spend 4 years at Howard University working under that crazy Zora Neale Hurston, I might add, just for Mr. Chase to have me chained to a desk all day writing about so-called women's issues, which we all know is just a place in the back of the paper reserved for baby announcements and the sharing of household cleaning tips. I would rather die. Why, Miss Ida B. Wells didn't allow herself to be chained to a desk, and neither will Velma Gifford. When I agreed to work for the Bee, its motto was all about stinging the enemies and providing honey for our friends, and now it's just like all the other rats. Why, that Mr. Chase should hold his head in shame. And to think, he went to Howard.
The phone rings. Leland picks up.
Whitelaw Hotel, Leland speaking. Yes, Mrs. Oliver, how can I help you? I see. Well, I don't think we should give the cat Pepto-Bismol, but I will have the kitchen send up some seltzer water. Yes, ma'am, right away.
Suddenly, William enters excitedly from the street.
Rita! Hey, Rita!
Rita enters with Birdie following close behind her. Birdie is wearing a maid's uniform and apron.
Heaven's sake, William. I heard you the first time. What are you in here yelling for?
A car just showed up with some white man in it.
But what are you doing in here? Get back out there and help the man.
Oh, yeah, right.
William exits to the street.
Wait a minute. Y'all let white folks stay here?
The Hay Adams must be sold out again.
But we coloreds can't afford to be racist, dear. White folks can pretty much stay wherever they want to.
But I wouldn't recommend we try to do the reverse.
Ooh, I'm so nervous. I ain't never done nothing like this before.
Your stuff, folks, is all the same.
And when they have money, easier to tell who's who. Oh, Rita, when Ms. Evans gets here, make sure to make all of her drinks doubles. Maybe if I can get her liquored up enough, I can finally get her gums a-flapping.
Who's Ms. Evans?
You know Esther Evans, the singer. What's that song she used to sing again?
Diamonds in the Sky.
Yes, that's it. Diamonds in the Sky.
Esther Evans? You mean the real Esther Evans? She's coming here. My mama say she the best singer I ever done been. Oh, Rita, I can't meet her looking like this. Oh, Lord, what am I gonna wear?
Why, your uniform, of course.
Oh, that's right. I just forgot. I do that sometimes.
Claudette enters looking very pleased with herself. William is behind her carrying a handful of shopping bags.
Now be gentle. You're not carrying a sack of potatoes.
Yes, ma'am.
William, in awe of Claudette, hurries over to the stairs and places the shopping bags down gingerly. Claudette removes her gloves and takes a seat at the bar.
Who's this white man you riding around town with?
Don't worry, I always sit in the back. Everyone just thinks I'm his maid.
My question was, who is he?
Just some guy I danced with a couple of times down at the caverns. He's awful sweet, though. A real crybaby. You know the type. The kind of man who'll give up his paycheck just to cry into your cleavage all night.
He sure must have eyes for you, driving you down here like that.
And she must have a death wish.
If colored wishes came true, Leland, I'd have a drink in my hand right now. Oh, that reminds me.
She pulls a bill from her purse and proudly waves it in Leland's face. Leland looks at her disapprovingly, but takes the bill.
Now, what does a paying guest have to do to get offered a drink around here?
Keep paying.
Leland reluctantly makes Claudette a drink.
Claudette, this here is my brother William and his girl Bertie. Irene. They're just helping us out for the holidays.
The one from the country? I should have known. He's a fine looking man, Rita. A very fine-looking man.
William blushes from the attention as Claudette circles him like prey.
He puts you in the mind of Canada Lee, don't you think?
I mean, he looks like the little brother who couldn't keep his fingers out his nose to me.
Then what you gonna tell her that for?
And I'm his fiance, Irene. Well, I will be his fiance soon. Isn't that right, William?
Well, either you are or you're not, dearie.
We just friends.
Close friends.
Close friends.
That's right. That's right.
I see. What a shame. I could have used a big, strong man like you to escort me to the Howard tomorrow night.
Placing a drink in front of Claudette.
The Howard? I would have thought the Claudette Chambers would be bringing in the new year somewhere fancy like the Mayor's Ball, not with us common folk down at the Howard Theater.
The Mayor's Ball? Please, even Velma here is too dark to get in that party. Besides, my going to the Howard won't be all fun. I plan on mixing a little business with my pleasure.
What's that supposed to mean?
It means I just signed up for the talent show.
Now that I would want to see.
Well, really, Claudette? I mean, I'll admit you can hold a tune, but I'm not sure if you're ready for the Howard. Folks can get awfully rowdy during that talent show.
Don't you worry about that. If my singing doesn't win them over, my new dress certainly will.
Don't scare her off the stage just yet, Rita. This could be great buzz for the Bee. I can see the headline now. Popular lady of the evening wins her salvation at the Howard Theater by Velma Gifford.
Oh, I do love to see my picture in the paper, but we're gonna have to work on that headline, Velma. I don't like it. Besides, I'm not looking to win the whole thing. Why, just coming in second will get you $20, and I need to start making some money if I plan on moving to New York. Heaven knows I can't keep dancing at the cabins forever. I tell you, if I hear Dear Lovely one more time, I'd probably drop dead.
I feel a sudden urge to sing the kind of ditty that invokes the spring.
Leland, for the record, when I said you were funny, I was talking about your looks, not your humor.
Well, if you do decide to drop dead, Lord knows they won't have a hard time replacing you down here at the cavern. Pretty colored girls who can sing and dance come a dime a dozen around here.
They can have my spot and all the dreams that come along with it. Trust me, the next Josephine Baker isn't going to emerge from the caverns. It's not as fancy as you think.
I work for the palace ballroom, but gee, that palace is cheap. When I get back to my chilly hall room, I'm much too tired to sleep. I'm one of those lady teachers. a beautiful hostess, you know, one that the palace features at exactly a dime a throw. 10 cents a dance, that's what they pay me. Gosh, how they weigh me down. 10 cents a dance. Pansies and rough guys, tough guys who tear my gown. 7 to midnight, I hear drums loudly, the saxophone blows. Trumpets are tearing my eardrums. Customers crush my toes. Sometimes I think I found my hero, but it's a queer romance. All that you need is a ticket. Come on, big boy, 10 cents a dance. Fighters and sailors and bow-legged tailors can pay for their tickets and rent me. Butchers and barbers and rats from the harbor are sweethearts my good luck has sent me. Though I've a chorus of elderly bones, stockings are porous with holes at the toes. I'm here till closing time. Death be merry, it's only a sign. Sometimes I think I found my hero, but it's a queer romance. All that you need is a ticket. Come on, big boy. 10 cents a time.
Well, if you hate it so much, why don't you just quit? With all the people you must know, I'm sure you could find someone to help you out.
Please, those high society color folks out there only know you when the sun goes down. But once that sun comes back up, they all go back to their respectable lives and families, while us taxi dancers are expected to take off all our dancing shoes and disappear until someone cranks up the band again.
But what about the one who just brought you all that stuff over there? Surely there's enough lace and ruffles in those bags to pay for a small mansion.
Claudette looks longingly at the numerous shopping bags at the bottom of the stairs.
Unfortunately, that horse has run its last race. I should have sent him out to pasture a long time ago.
But that's what happens when you run around with married men.
Married?
Please, all of them are married. I wouldn't want it any other way. It's easier that way. When they're married, the rules are already set. The lines are drawn, and we both know not to cross them. At least, I thought he knew.
Knew what?
Not to fall in love. He broke the rules. He crossed the line. And now I can't play with him no more.
But what about you? I mean, do you?
Do I what? Love her? Honey, it wouldn't matter much if I did.
You can say that again.
Folks come up here and forget we still in the South.
Well, tell them walk past a couple of blocks of U Street and they'll be reminded.
What about Jack Johnson? He married a white woman.
Yeah, and we all know how that all worked out.
Look, I don't care nothing about no Jack Johnson or his dead wife. All I know is that where I come from, the only thing a colored woman can share with a white man is a bed. And since we've already done that, I don't, for the life of me, understand why he's still hanging around. They usually disappear and cut me off by now.
Maybe this one here is different.
Or maybe he's just slow.
Claudette gathers her things.
Now, if you'll all excuse me, I think that's enough sharing for one day.
Claudette collects her bags and heads upstairs to her room. Birdie watches her climb the steps in awe before she turns back to the others.
Isn't it amazing how someone so pretty can be so sad? It's just like what happened in that Ginger Rogers movie, Top Hat. See, what had happened was Ginger met this man that had like big scrunchie.
Birdie's story is interrupted when the front door flies open. BJ bursts in a huff. He runs directly to the piano and starts to clear it off to play it. Leland understands immediately what is happening and reacts.
No. BJ, I've already told you she can't just take over the entire lobby. You're gonna have to find somewhere else.
BJ ignores Leland and snaps his fingers towards Birdie.
A little help, please.
Birdie runs over to BJ and helps him clear off the piano.
Thanks, doll. Look, Leland, it's one song. I just need the piano. I didn't even bring the band. Hey, buddy, there's some more luggage outside the door. Do you mind?
Sure, no problem at all.
William exits to help.
Now, wait a minute. You can't be storming in here barking orders.
Leland, you knew she was coming. The manager at the Howard reserved the suite last month.
A suite, yes. They didn't say anything about the lobby.
Well, who's using it? Because unless something is wrong with my peepers, it looks awful empty to me.
Look, I'm sure Rita can find you a nice space down at the Y for you to rehearse. Rita.
BJ pulls Leland aside and pleads with him softly.
Leland, please, I need this.
Leland retreats, heading back behind the counter. BJ goes back to the piano. Esther Evans enters in a blaze of glory. She is a glamorous woman, wearing a full-length fur coat. She marches towards the piano as if she was on a mission, peeling out of her coat as she moves.
You got that old thing warmed up yet, boy?
Almost.
Well, hurry up. I need to get this song out of my head before I forget it.
She stops, noticing Leland and Rita.
Well, ain't it the newlyweds? Well, come on, let me see that handcuff.
Rita walks over to Esther and holds out her left hand. Esther scoops it up and looks at the ring.
Well, at least you won't be disappointed if you lose it.
Looking up at the chandelier.
Well, would you look at this here? That old fool done finally got his chandelier. Ain't it something? BJ, you seen this here thing?
Yeah, real fancy, Ma.
Rita, how long y'all done had this thing up here?
Well, I say about 6 months now.
Well, it sure is something.
Mrs. Evans, Velma Gifford with the Washington Bee. I was just wondering if...
The Washington Bee? I ain't known them to have no women reports.
I'm the first one.
Well, you had to go to school to get that job. Or did you sleep with somebody?
I studied journalism at Howard University.
Howard, huh? Did you graduate?
Yes, ma'am. Class of 22.
Well,
You look like you got some sense. You got a pen to go with that pad?
Why, yes, ma'am.
Good. Follow me.
Velma quickly follows Esther to the piano.
Now, I need you to write down this here song for me. If it comes out of my mouth, write it down. Got it?
Yes, ma'am.
BJ, boy, are you ready?
BJ bangs on the keys to indicate his readiness. Esther settles down on the couch and continues to bark orders. William enters bearing suitcases.
Now be careful, boy, you hear me? That's real genuine leather you got in your hands.
Yes, Miss Evans.
Oh, and lock that door behind me, you hear me? I don't want nobody walking in on me while I'm trying to work out this here song. My buster always said, never let them hear it before it's ready. See, that's how they get you.
I'm sorry, Miss Evans, but we can't do that. We're expecting other guests.
Shooting BJ a death stare.
BJ, I thought you handled this. What was the point of me sending you down here a day early if you wasn't going to handle the business like I told you?
BJ looks totally embarrassed. Leland sees this and comes to his rescue.
Rita, if you'd please.
Rita goes to the front door and locks it. She then turns the close sign around. BJ mouths a thank you to Leland.
Now, this here is a closed rehearsal. That means what goes on in this room stays in this room until I say otherwise. You hear me?
Esther lets her fur coat fall to the floor. Birdie runs over to gather it. Esther never looks back. Instead, she walks over to the side of the piano and turns her attention to BJ.
BJ, play that melody I was humming in the car. You remember it?
I think I got it.
Esther turns and gives him a mama look.
Either you got it or you don't.
I got it, Ma. I got it.
Turning to Velma.
Now you try to keep up. You hear me? If I stump my damn toe, I want to hear the owl on that piece of paper. You hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
BJ starts to play. Esther nods her head to the music.
That's it. But take it down. Why gotta be so high, BJ? What you playing all up there for? Ain't nobody up there no more. There's a small hotel with a wishing well. I wish that we were there together. There's a bridal suite, one room bright and neat, complete for us to share together. You can see a distant steeple, not a sign of people. Who needs people when the steeple bell says good night, sleep well? We'll thank the small hotel together. Play, BJ. I wrote this one here for my buster. May he rest in peace until I get there. Together. You can see a distant steeple, not a sign of people. Who needs people when the steeple bell says good night, sleep well? We'll thank the small hotel and creep into
into our shell. We'll thank the small hotel. Together.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, it seems that's all our playwright is going to give us this evening. But keep your radios tuned in to Restoration Stage Radio for part two of Live from the Whitelaw Hotel. I'm your host, Harris James, and it has been a pleasure sharing this time with you this evening. And for heaven's sake, remember to drink your Ovaltine. That's Ovaltine, the remarkable bedtime drink that lets you relax naturally. Good night.